Hello, hi, good evening, or should I say, welcome into the night, a lovely, warm, and darkening night, I might say, in which we're gonna look deep into the abyss of the gruesome and the gory, of the suspense and the things that creep namelessly through us, through the world, and through our stories. So tonight I have two of the finest Latin American writers with me whose work take elements of horror and transform it to what could be called the future of both morality and the horror genre. And the coming hours, but I'm going to take you that first hour and leave you to the rest of the night. So the coming hour, we will delve into their worlds, into what makes us as readers and tick, and where the beauty lies in the darkness of their literary worlds. I will be your dark but pleasant host, Elfie Tromp, and I'm currently traveling through Holland with my vampire theater show, Not Today Satan, but please come tonight at the Parade. So the horror genre holds no secrets for me. And before I introduce my first author to read, I want her to sing, because I have the honor to introduce to you Paula Oleksiak, who was born in Buenos Aires, has lived in San Francisco and currently resides in Barcelona. And she's a regular contributor for the New York Times and a columnist in La Nation. Her novels, Savage Theories and Mona, have been translated in several languages. And with her latest Mona, she takes the genre of horror to a whole new setting. We will talk about that later. But besides writing, she is one of the finest, I might say, mezzo-sopranos out there, or at least here at the festival. So, and she is accompanied, and I want to say the name right, by Walid Ben Salim. Thank you, Lord. Walid Ben Salim, so can I get a really warm, and maybe a little haunting applause for Paula Oleksiak and Walid Ben Salim.
De la niña. Se había ido paseo.
Yo sé que metido, viví esperando querer, que querés hallar olvido, cambiando tanta mujer. Yo sé que en la madrugada farra dejar. Sentís el pecho oprimido por un recuerdo querido y te pones a llorar.
And in the darkness, the host lurks. There's for me two stages to choose from. So I want to invite Pola. Could you come to the stage, please, and have another round of applause, please? Come on. Thank you so much. So what I understood, you rehearsed this piece today. You put it together today for the first time together.
Oh, yeah. I don't think this is working.
Is it working? We're just going to wait and look menacingly to the technicians. Yeah, I see fearful fright from them coming. If you keep on talking, it's going to start working.
So, yeah, I met today Walid, who's fantastic.
He's coming up and look at your technician. So, Paula, if I'm correct, we are listening to a piece of your main character, Mona, from your novel that you just did. It's a monologue that you performed.
Yes.
It's a story of extreme violence. And I have the English translation, and I think it might be good to maybe read it as well, because we didn't get the translation on the screen. Would you be willing to do that for us, or is that maybe too much?
Yeah, is this working or not?
We're going to use that microphone, and I have the translation. Ah,
there you go.
Okay.
A lot of microphones in the house.
Yes, so So the novel, my novel, Mona, is about this Peruvian writer who is abroad in a literary festival, but she's escaping a very odd and horrifying situation that she lived in. But she didn't quite live it, because she's blocking it in California. So when she arrives in Europe, she's following the news of what's going on with this like young Peruvian girl, and she's like following this case, and so when in fact she realizes what happened, because they found the body of the little girl that she's following in the news, she is in fact invited at this festival in order to sing. So and so I thought that, you know, that's, I mean, even if in autofiction, which is a genre of writing, writers are taking themselves as characters. Well, I did the opposite. So my character was doing something, and I was, okay, this is what I have to do then. So I had to sing, because my character sings Mona. And so I sing this tango. This is a part of a tango composed by Azucena Maizani. She was one of the very few women who composed tangos. She composed this in 1928, and she was also an interpreter of it. That's why it has, like, you know, this like very high tune. In the novel, Mona sings a bolero, but this is like a kind of like this kind of shocking moment, because she realizes of this horrifying death, and she's like also kind of in the path of like looking out of what actually happened to her, that she has been blocking, you know, with this moving around in between planes and festivals and trying to be a person at the same time.
Perfectly explained. Would you be willing to read the fragment for us translated in English?
Yes.
All right, perfect. I'm going to sit down in the darkness, and then later you can join me.
A woman who worked in a meat locker said that she remembered that night. The night the girl disappeared, she'd been seen walking with a man, and they got in a car. Now the news was being reported by all the big Lima newspapers. Sandrita had been found on the banks of the Rimac River, with signs of having been strangled and gang-raped. They dragged her through the weeds, and her wounds indicated the involvement of more than one person. The press had started to call her the Ophelia of the Rimac. Mona felt her throat beating like a reptile. Motionless, she felt the weight of an aggressor over her. She couldn't move. She closed her eyes beneath the blows, felt the clay between her fingers. Hate was in an incandescent odor, attempting to break her. Her pinioned legs kicked in terror. Her fingernails were useless. It was impossible to defend herself. She was reduced to a ball of flesh and hair. She was beaten under the water. How long did bruises last underwater? This is the fragment that we did. Thank you. And a round for Walid, who's fantastic, and I met him today in an Indonesian restaurant.
Oh, you met him today? Bravo, okay. Walid. Well, good spirits.
So we come here?
Please join me on the second stage, I might say. So, Paula, now a haunted house is an obvious setting for the horror genre, maybe at a forest by night. Tell me what's so gruesome about the literary world.
Well, I think one of the most interesting things is that everybody's being themselves. And so you can really like squeeze out the monster of everyone. And to me, it was quite a discovery that I could no longer suffer from anxiety if I looked at everyone as a character. So I was like, okay, I'm really enjoying like all this horrible thing that's going on, for example. And this is quite fantastic because I can take notes and that was kind of my way of controlling it and of dealing with it. And it was fantastic because like, I don't know, I remember being in places like, for example, Brazil, which is fantastic and one of my favorite places in the world, but it's also like monarchic in the bad sense, not in the beautiful sense like you guys that have an Argentinian queen, and you know, who's also like a drag queen and fantastic. Mm. But yeah, that they would tell you, like, okay, so did you bring a leopard bikini to the festival? I read that you'd heard that, and this was like the main newspaper. This was just so insane. It was just like part of life, that it was kind of like a cute thing to ask, like what kind of underwear I was wearing, and I don't know, it was just so natural. I mean, this is just like a sexist example, just you know, in order to keep with the theme, because I was you know in the other show, and it really feels like we're going through a whole requiem. But I think it's interesting to do this cathartic work, and well, for me, like writing is a very it can be cathartic because I can turn like my monsters into like even more monstrous people, and this is something that I enjoy.
And the monster within yourself.
Yes, naturally.
Perfect. So I have one question before I introduce the second speaker of the night, and I'm going to ask you to answer it honestly. Has there been some darkness within this festival, the Winternachten? You've been here for a couple of days now.
Well, that's exactly why I'm here and what I'm trying to find out. And hopefully I will find out tonight.
I love that, thank you. So the second author I have the honor to introduce to you is a writer that has made me shudder. In the meat section of the supermarket, I've been avoiding butchers ever since finishing her novel. Argentinian writer Agustina Bastarrica wrote an evenly eloquent as brutal dystopia, or I can also say it's reality, with her novel Tender is the Flesh, in which she answers a very simple question. What do we do with our meat cravings when animals cease to exist? And the answer is very simple. The systems already thought of and put in place, and it's a mere swapping of species. We can breed humans as food. Her novel was awarded the prestigious Premio Clarín Novella Prize and has been translated in over a dozen languages. Can I have a warm applause for Agustina Basterrica? And Agustina, you can choose. There's so many places you can read. First stage, second stage.
But my mic.
Your mic's on. You right. can also sit yeah. in the middle and take yeah. center stage. Yeah. A lot of freedom. You're going to be reading from Tender is the Flesh, Cadavre Exquisito.
Yeah, in Spanish.
Yes.
I will read.
And the main character is Marcos. We follow yes. him. He. Okay.
I'm but I don't want to tell the okay. plot because you will find it really quickly.
Okay.
When I'm reading, and afterwards we can talk. But first, I want to say something that I said yesterday, that I'm really grateful to be here, and I think it's a privilege. So, well, I'm honored. And I'm really thanked to be with a colleague, an Argentine colleague. This is not yeah. that common yeah. to find in another festival, in another country, a colleague from your country. So,
I was wondering, yeah. did you know each other beforehand?
No,
we didn't know each other's work.
Because she doesn't, you don't live in Argentina. You live in there everywhere. So, no this but is the first time we meet.
Yeah, but I'm so thrilled to meet Agustina. I'm so fascinated by her work, and also I love her translator Heather Cleary in English. She's fantastic.
All right. Well, I'm quite excited. You will be reading for us.
Yeah, I will read some fragments. So.
And you will be reading in Spanish, and then
Spanish.
It'll be translated.
I think they will translate it.
Okay. Well, good luck.
I can read it in English, but I don't have a copy.
So mine is backstage, but I think the translation is up, right? I think so, yes.
Okay, I will start. Media res, aturdidor, línea de sacrificio, baño de aspersión. Esas palabras aparecen en su cabeza y lo golpean, lo destrozan. Pero no son solo palabras. Son la sangre, el olor denso, la automatización, el no pensar. Irrumpen en la noche cuando está desprevenido. Se despierta con una capa de sudor que le cubre el cuerpo porque sabe que le espera otro día de faenar humanos. Nadie lo llama así, piensa, mientras prende un cigarrillo. Él no lo llama así cuando tiene que explicarle a un empleado nuevo cómo es el ciclo de la carne. Podrían arrestarlo por hacerlo. Podrían incluso mandarlo al matadero municipal y procesarlo. Asesinarlo sería la palabra exacta, aunque no la permitida. Mientras se saca la remera empapada, trata de despejar la idea persistente de que son eso, humanos criados para ser animales comestibles. Va a la heladera y se sirve agua helada. La toma despacio. Su cerebro le advierte que hay palabras que encubren el mundo. Hay palabras que son convenientes, higiénicas, legales.
They're
not translating.
I'm seeing there, everyone's looking at the lab, and nobody okay, told great. Me we've got the translation with you. So perfect.
Okay, so it's fine. Great. I'll continue.
It's like a. No, I've read the book, so I know it by heart. Pretty okay. much. Yeah.
I read the other part. Cuando Spanel abrió la carnicería, imitaba los cortes vacunos tradicionales para que el cambio no fuese tan abrupto. Uno entraba y parecía que estaba en una carnicería de antaño. Con el tiempo fue mutando de manera gradual pero persistente. Primero fueron las manos envasadas a un costado, disimuladas entre las milanesas a la provenzal, la colita de cuadril y los riñones. El envase tenía la etiqueta de carne especial y en un apartado la aclaración de extremidad superior, evitando estratégicamente poner la palabra mano. Con el tiempo agregó pies envasados para que se presentaran sobre un colchón de lechugas con la etiqueta de extremidad inferior y más adelante una bandeja con lenguas, penes, narices, testículos con un cartel que decía Delicias Spanel. Al poco tiempo y basándose en los cortes de los cerdos, la gente empezó a llamar a las extremidades superiores manitos y a las inferiores patitas. Con ese permiso y con esos diminutivos que anulaban el espanto, la industria las catalogó de esa manera. Hoy ya vende brochettes de orejas y dedos a las que apoda brochettes mixtas, vende licores con glóbulos oculares, lengua a la vinagreta. The other part. This is a little bit longer. Sergio se acerca a los candidatos y les da la mano. Él hace uno de los trabajos más importantes, que es aturdir cabezas. Las desmaya con un golpe para que después las degüellen. Mostrales, Sergio. Les dice a los candidatos que suban a unos escalones construidos debajo de la ventana. De esa manera tienen la altura suficiente para ver lo que pasa dentro del box. Sergio entra en la sala de boxes y sube a la plataforma. Agarra la masa, grita, dale, mandá. Se abre la puerta guillotina y entra una hembra desnuda que apenas pasa de los 20 años. Está mojada y tiene las manos atadas a la espalda con un precinto de plástico. Está rapada. El espacio del box es estrecho, moverse le resulta casi imposible. Sergio ajusta el grillete de acero inoxidable que corre por un riel vertical a la altura del cuello de la hembra y lo cierra. La hembra tiembla, se sacude un poco, se quiere soltar, abre la boca. Sergio la mira a los ojos y le da pequeñas palmadas en la cabeza que parecen casi una caricia. Le dice algo que ellos no oyen o le canta. La hembra se queda quieta, más calmada. Sergio levanta la masa y le pega en la frente. Es un golpe seco, tan rápido y silencioso que es demencial. La hembra se desmaya. Su cuerpo se afloja y cuando Sergio abre el grillete, el cuerpo cae. Se abre la puerta basculante y la base del box se inclina para expulsar el cuerpo que se desliza al piso. Un empleado entra y ata los pies con correas sujetas a cadena. Le corta el precinto de plástico que aprisiona las manos y toca un botón. El cuerpo se eleva y con un sistema de rieles es transportado boca abajo a otro cuarto. El empleado mira el cuarto de descanso y lo saluda con un gesto. Él no recuerda el nombre, pero sabe que lo contrató hace un par de meses. El empleado agarra una manguera y lava el box y el piso manchados con excrementos. El más alto se baja de los escalones y se sienta en una silla con la cabeza gacha. Él piensa, ahora vomita, pero se para y se recompone. Entra Sergio con una sonrisa orgulloso de la demostración. ¿Y qué les pareció? ¿Quieren probar? El otro se acerca y le dice, sí, yo. Pero Sergio larga una carcajada y le dice, no, papito, para eso te falta mucho. El otro parece decepcionado. Te explico, querido. Si me los matás de un golpe, me arruinás la carne. Y si no me los desmayás y entran vivos al sacrificio, también me arruinás la carne, ¿me comprendés? Y abraza al otro mientras lo sacude un poco riéndose. Estos pibes de hoy, tejo, quieren llevarse el mundo por delante y no saben ni caminar. Todos se ríen, menos el otro. Sergio le explica que los principiantes usan la pistola de perno cautivo. Tiene menos margen de error, ¿te das cuenta? Pero la carne no queda tan tiernita. Ricardo, el otro aturdidor, que ahora está descansando afuera, usa la pistola y se está entrenando para usar la masa. Está acá hace 6 meses y remata, usar la masa es solo para los entendidos. El más alto pregunta qué le dijo a la carne, por qué le habló. Él se sorprende que la llame carne a la hembra aturdida y no cabeza o producto. Sergio le contesta que cada aturdidor tiene su secreto sobre cómo calmarlos antes de aturdirlos, que cada aturdidor nuevo tiene que encontrar su manera. ¿Por qué no gritan? Dice el más alto. Él no quiere contestar, él quiere estar en otra parte, pero está ahí. Es Sergio el que contesta, no tienen cuerdas vocales. El otro se sube a los escalones y mira la sala de los boxes. Apoya las manos en la ventana, hay ansiedad en la mirada, hay impaciencia. Él piensa que ese candidato es peligroso. Alguien con tantas ganas de asesinar es alguien inestable. Alguien que no puede asumir la rutina de matar. El gesto automático y desapasionado de faenar humanos. Wow, that is all.
Agustina, I know you read Stephen King. And
yeah.
I was wondering, Paula, are you also an avid fan of the horror genre, or did the horror creep in while you were writing, Mona?
I don't think I've ever read a Stephen King novel. I've watched the films, and I have to say that they are absolutely wonderful. I don't know. I like the kind of terror that I love. It's usually psychological. So I like when you're reading and you realize that, you know, that there is this point of view that is being created, and it like runs like a liquid, and it's an abrasive liquid. It's, you know, it's like an acid onto things, and I don't know. Like I really like kind of like the texture of points of view, mostly, more than, I don't know, more than like wonderful stories, because even though I absolutely love wonderful stories, I don't know, there's something that I find addictive about like putting myself in the point of view of like another world. And so I'm always looking for this like odd points of view, and so like my horror passion goes like in that direction, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Both your work consists not solely of horror stories, but also other literary genres. And I wonder, would I ungrace you if I would call you a horror writer? In Holland, we're quite reluctant to admit we're a genre writer. It's somehow seen as less literary. I wonder how that is for you.
I think the same. In Argentina, this novel, it's considered a dystopia, mm-hmm. like the science fiction genre. Mm-hmm. But since in United States, the ladies of horror fiction, they start considering a terror novel. So I think everything is literature. Mm. And I read everything. It's not that I read only terror. I start reading terror books when I won that prize, and they started to invite me to talk about terror.
So interesting.
So, and the same with dystopia. When I wrote this, I wasn't thinking about, I want to write a dystopia. I just wrote it, and even though I didn't read at the time dystopia, mm-hmm. or reread, but I start studying about the genre when they start inviting me to talk about it.
You've been talking about it all around the world, because the terrifying world of the literary scene and the festivals and somehow the, let's say, intellectual carnival, it's everywhere. I spoke to a lot of authors backstage yesterday, and the one says, oh, I'm going to Berlin afterwards. Where are you going? Oh, Turkey. I'm going to see you in Greece at the end of the summer. And it's like this, you don't think about it, but these are kind of like rock stars also on tour, but like a literary tour.
I hope.
And you have to talk and regurgitate everything about your novel every time on a stage like this with a nice, sometimes not so nice person like me.
And with
you
that
are
dress,
fantastic.
And
you
with
know,
that dress,
you are
come
absolutely
on.
Fantastic.
Thank you. I'm almost getting my period, so you know, I'm channeling the energy. Anyways, that's beside the topic. I'm sorry. But I was wondering, how broadly speaking, how does horror relate to society in Latin America? But also, how have you, being on talks like this, maybe seeing cultural differences in approaches to horror? It's maybe a very difficult question. Just feel free to answer.
I can answer this. Mm. We heard what Paula read, mm-hmm. and that is happening every day.
Femicide.
Every day. I don't know. Yeah, every day. And in Mexico, I was recently in Mexico, and the femicides are really the worst.
Boom.
And yeah, and what they do now is that they kidnap girls from the street, they take them to a hotel, and they test them. I don't know what are the parameters to test them. And if they pass the test, they will put them in a, I don't know how you call it in English. ¿Cómo se dice?
Like in a brothel.
In a brothel, thank you. In a brothel. And if not, they will just throw them again on the street. So that is happening now in Mexico. So that is horror you live every
sexual
day.
Sexual slavery.
Yeah. Yeah, because you never know what can happen to you because you're a woman. Mm. I mean, men can be afraid of many things. Maybe walking down the street, they can be afraid that someone can steal them. But they will never be afraid of a woman trying to rape them.
Mm-mm.
That never happened, I think, in the history of humanity. So that for me, it's a vibe that, well, I need to talk about, to write. And it's not, well, I didn't read that part, but the protagonist here, they give him a gift. They give him a female to breed or to eat. And it's not casual that I choose a female, because she is representing all the women that are silenced in the world, not only because they are killed, but all because they are invisible in some way.
Mm. I feel like there's also a part that really relates to us and the way that we can construct like a point of view of horror, or to me that's the way that I feel it, because of course like these things are horrifying and we feel very sorry for the victims. But then I also feel like that, you know, we, the ladies, are trained to always have this point of view that is kind of like above your head, that is kind of like, you know, checking, you know, what you're doing, not just because somebody is going to come and attack you, but also because, you know, you are trained to be in a certain way, to please, you know, centuries of doing that, of course, like take a toll. And it's just so constant that you kind of like start narrating yourself in the point of view of like how you are seen. So to me, that is like a point of view of horror, because it feels like, you know, usually like in the films you have this, you know, like there's something like standing and like, you're, oh, no, don't go there because, you know, something horrible is going to happen to you or something like that. Well, I feel like as a girl, this happens too, that, you know, that there is like this outside kind of omniscient narrator, and then, you know, like your body doing things, or your like your consciousness, you know, on the loose, and so this was an inspiration for me to when I wrote Mona, because like I wanted to talk about, you know, other things that happens in literary festivals, such as the way that, you know, people, well, there is an identity politics market for people to engage and to speak about, and in a way you are kind of like coerced into playing a role, into playing your part. This is what society kind of expects from you. Usually, like the host society kind of like feels good when they're like taking in, you know, like one of, you know, the people from the lower hierarchy. Or that happened to me in the States quite a lot, because I was invited to speak as a person of color, and I didn't know like this like racial way of, you know, of qualifying people. I literally didn't know, but I realized that if I went into the States, I became a person of color, and if I leave the States, I was not a person of color anymore, because people just don't use that kind of racial subtype. And well, so this is part of like the dance that can be macabre or terrorific or not of the literary festivals, and what, you know, societies or you know, yeah,
all the masks you put on and are put on as well.
Yes, that are put on, and how you are like lip servicing and kind of like, you know, making the other people feel better because, you know, they're listening to you, like, oh, like you're such a victim, and this is, I mean, I feel so much better after talking to you, and so I don't know, I think that's a comedy, and it's also lovely that we get to play with these morality things, and that, you know, I don't know, people gather in order to feel better about themselves, because like, what else are you going to do? But if you could add like this horror perspective of like being, of what being a girl is and how you are haunted because of that, well, to me that was quite an inspiration. That's what I wanted to do.
What lurks in the shadows when we go outside is more dangerous for women on the streets than it is for men.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. So in both novels, as we are talking about sexual violence, there is an element of rape, obvious rape, but there's also a rape that is regarded as healthy or maybe like consensual sex by the main character, like the rape of the female butcher in Marcos. And there's a female butcher that she has one of the most favorite quotations. I'm going to freely cite it now. She says, "When you smile, we see your skeleton. I don't smile because then you see my skeleton," which is a very haunting, fleeting image. I love that. But there's also the sex that he has with the female bread for kettle, the head that he's given the female. And in Mona, she's fleeing away or suppressing a violent history she underwent. And later in the book, she does have somewhat consensual sex with another writer called Sven in chapter 9, or I'm not sure if it was a writer.
Should have been Dutch, I guess.
Like. Yeah. But there's that element of how can sex be consensual when there's such a difference in power, almost.
Yeah. In my novel, the butcher, she's a woman, she rapes him first when he is young.
True, I forgot that, but yes.
Yeah. And afterwards, they have consent sex. But what he does with Jasmine, that is the female, I think it's not equal, because although she apparently wants to, I mean, she's not forcing it, they're not pairs, because she's like an animal in a sense. Mm. So it's polemical. You say polemical?
Yeah. Yeah, you're putting this all out there. I was thinking about my dog that usually humps my leg like ever a couple of times a month. And he loves me so much, but then I'm just like, yeah, but you also, it's also because I feed you, that's why you love me so much, not because you love my legs, unfortunately. But so I was thinking about that, like, it cannot be consensual.
In a way, it's not, because she doesn't think as a human, because she wasn't bred as a person. Mm. She doesn't think as a person. She is a human, but she's also meat, and she's a product. So I don't know. It's a difficult relation there. I talk in a lot of schools in Argentina, because they give the book as a cheating material. And teenagers always ask me if it is a rape or not. And I just explain, and they have to take their own conclusion.
And I think that's like the gray area that we're so uncomfortable talking about. And we so want to say, I'm a good person, I'm a bad person, or what am I doing?
Yeah, and I think that Marcos is like, has gray areas like we all do. He has a dark side like we all do. So I wanted to create this character with these layers, you know, a lot of layers.
Yeah. So if we move on to Mona, she is someone that's trying to flee reality, to what happened to her, by using a lot of drugs, a lot of mind-altering states. And she has this somehow pure interaction with this Sven, that also asks her, I want you to be safe. Will you promise me? But it's obviously a futile promise she can make, because it's an unsafe world. Did you want to try... Can you elaborate on that meeting with this Sven character at the end of the book and the sexual intercourse or the interactions that they have?
Well, I think she's quite terrified when she's there and she's trying to be, I don't know, professional or to be a person or to have like a, you know, like a life and not just be a victim, because it's very, you know, it's also a trap place if you cannot leave there, because you know you would have to always live. I mean, it's very tricky. So she falls for this guy, or is attracted to him, and there is a certain gray area, of course. But I don't think that we should ever leave out that gray area from literature. I think books will be so boring if like all the encounters were perfectly pure and curated, and like there is no, you know, power imbalance. I mean, just books would just
be about like being like, oh, we feel good about ourselves because this book is pure, it's not touching anything wrong that it shouldn't touch, and so we are fine now. And I don't think this is what literature should do at all. And I think, yeah, books are there to make us uncomfortable and also to experiment with things that you know, it's better not to experiment in reality, but at least it's good if we, you know, see them and put ourselves in both the position of the person that does the harm and also in the position of the victim. I think you can learn also so much from the person that does the harm than from the victim, even if, of course, like nobody wants to be on the harm side because you will get canceled. And also because, you know, of course, moral acts that are evil should be punished. But I don't think we should like pre-punish. We shouldn't like just like overrule all the things that just don't really fit with what we now feel this is like, I don't know, our ethics, the ethics of our time. I think we are experimenting with the ethics of our time. And in this sense, I think this is also part of what we were saying before, like when there are things that you say, and when you're playing the role of the victim side, or you're also playing the role of like the society that didn't go too well, and I don't know, this is empowering for both places, because like we all get to listen to each other, and I think that's very cool. And we have to make fun of that too. It's not so serious. It shouldn't be so serious.
Was that we were experimenting with the ethics of our society?
Yes,
is that
what we are.
Saying? I love that. I love that idea. Both novels seem to carry the message that in a violent world, as we are living in, however we try to soften it by morals and laws and, you know, good behavior and... the only chance of intimacy in both your works is through complicity, through becoming one part of the violence.
Yes.
Is that something you would agree with?
That's so interesting what you're
saying. Yes.
And also very dark image of love.
Yes. Yeah, in my book it's really, really dark.
It's amazing. Yeah, I never thought of that.
Yeah.
But maybe it's because we're Argentine.
Yes.
Yeah. We're always on kind of like on the side of evil, right?
Yes.
Oh, you got a lot to be angry about. I know all about being a woman. So about being a woman, we have invited a Dutch poet, Jentel van Stockholm, to write a haunted poem especially for this event. Jentel is a renowned poet here with an obsession for Emily Dickinson. And Bronte, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I wrote it down wrong, sorry.
It's okay.
But I did read it and I loved it.
I love Dickinson as well.
But Bronte is obviously the superior one. All right.
Oh, she was there first. Dickinson was also a fan of Bronte, so it's okay.
Okay, good.
So no,
we got that correct. I'm sorry. Emily Bronte. And that, I may say, resulted in an amazingly powerful poetry collection in Dutch called I Say Emily. But for now, there is a poem, Wat gebeurt er met de geesten die geen lichaam vinden? And it's translated as, What happens to spirits that don't find a body? And it's translated by Rosalind Buck. Please, a hand of applause for Jentel van Stockholm.
I guess this is my place. Wat gebeurt er met geesten die geen lichaam vinden? Geen levend wezen kan binnen de realiteit blijven bestaan zonder langzaam, nee, gestaag, waanzinnig te worden. De eerste tekenen zijn er. Vannacht neem ik temperatuurveranderingen mee. Een koude plek in een ruimte, maar de koelte is er. Maar de koelte is welkom en stil als mijn voetstappen. Terwijl de zon opkomt, zomer vroeg, Pak ik me opnieuw over jouw slapeloze lichaam. Pak opnieuw jouw slapeloze hand. Voel opnieuw die slapeloze polsslag. Registreer de trilling in een ader, de trilling in een ooglid. Staar naar hoe het leven door jouw lichaam kruipt als een hommel ontregeld na een te warme winter. Zoekend. Inmiddels weet je dat ik van daglicht houd en hoe het op mij valt. Het liefst had je iedere zonnestraal gebroken, scherven als suikerglas op de grond, waarschuwend knarsend. Ik trek het laken over je heen. Mijn voeten wrijven koel als water langs de jouwe. Ik heb me voorgenomen geen spijt te hebben van mijn alomtegenwoordigheid. Ik benadruk dat. Ik observeer het kosmos op jouw slapen en hoe onkruid in ons bed is gaan woekeren. Distels hardnekkig groeiend uit hoofdkussens, stekend en stekend, zo verandert ook ons bed in een graf. Stuur ze penwortels en wat je daar al niet mee hebt gedaan, het azijnzuur dat je kocht en hoe je hebt gegraven. Donkere aarde onder broze nagels. Je hebt je handen gewassen tot ze rood waren. Tot ze brandden. En hoe je overwoog het bed in brand te steken. Maar was dat niet wat extreem, et cetera? Nu heb je keer op keer dezelfde koortsstroom. Ook dat is een teken. Ik die op jouw borstkas drukt, op jouw hart, die razende motor. Ik die mijn vingers om jouw onrustige adem leg, deze naar me toe trek. Ik wikkel hem om me heen, hij is warm, ik had het kouder dan ik dacht. Lach, wanneer jouw ogen openvliegen, wijd als de mond van een kind dat roept om zijn moeder, groot als de mond van een kind dat roept. Heb ik je niet beloofd te blijven? Op iedere pijp geklopt, iedere radio op mij afgesteld, steeds de verkeerde zender en het is niet mijn schuld. Ook in dit leven blijk ik een wond permanent bloeiend. Je ziet me liever als het donker is. Omdat het voorspelbaar is, gok ik zo en voor het gemak. Je zou over aarde donker kunnen praten alsof je er bent geweest. Alsof je ook beetje bij beetje werd bedolven. Kleine stenen, zachte takken, de klitten van de kleinste wortels samengebald. Alsof er geen licht was. Alsof het licht niet wordt benadrukt door de afwezigheid ervan. Alsof wat afwezig is niet meer bestaat. Ik dwaal af. Waarom zou ik het je gemakkelijk maken? Ik heb mezelf al 100 keer uit moeten graven. Niet te tellen hoe ik opnieuw de kop opsteek. Hoe ik opnieuw geroepen word. Ik word wakker wanneer jij aan mij denkt. Of niet aan mij denkt. Omdat er klaprozen in de velden staan en je zacht het woord oorlog zegt. Hoe moet ik mij niet geroepen voelen? Ik word wakker wanneer jij je uitstrekt naar een zwart geblakende zon, je armen spreidt, mijn gezicht aanraakt. Ik word wakker wanneer jij mijn gezicht aanraakt. In dit wanhopige tijdperk manifesteer ik me moeiteloos.
So thank you, Jento, for that. I have goosebumps, and it's not only because of the air conditioning. Thank you for this haunting poem, indeed. We're moving into the last 5 minutes of our talk, but I wanted to talk about something that we all love, readers and writers alike, and that's the many uses of language and how it can shield or shade or transform the true nature of meaning. There's a philosopher, Peter Singer, who says in his book Animal Liberation Front that we use different words for meat processing than we would for murder. We sanitize language as soon as we differentiate humans from animals, but we are in fact all animals. bad news, good news, I'm not sure. Agustina, you did a lot of research in the workings of the bio industry, the mechanics of it, and you came across so many names or sanitizing names for acts of violence. What is one that is stuck with you or that has stayed with you?
It was previous to the idea of the novel, and it is a documentary that you can watch it on YouTube. It's called Earthlings, and it shows you how we process all the animals. Not only the dogs and cats people just abandoned and they kill them with gas, but of course cows, pigs, they cut their tail because they are so
overcrowded.
Crowded, yeah. Like crowded, that they start eating each other. They show you how they cut the cock of the chickens because they start also picking each other. They show you how they use animals on labs and laboratory for experiment, and they torture them. And they also show you an image that I will never forget in my life, that is that they tear the skin of animals and they're alive because the skin gets out better if they're alive than if they're dead. So when I saw that, I start crying. I never cry. I love horror movies. But my husband came and said, why are you crying? I mean, what is happening here? You are crying? And I couldn't speak. I was like, and I stopped eating meat after that. And because I stopped eating meat, the idea of the novel Aroused came.
Yeah, but there's, so it's actually the namelessness, like it, the gruesomeness is so horrible.
Yeah.
Because they, for example, the beaking, unbeaking, they don't call it mutilating, which it is, but they call it unbeaking or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, like, for example, in Argentina, we call the nuggets, we call it like little feet. It would be the translation, no? The patitas.
Patitas de pollo.
Yeah, patitas de pollo, like little feet.
Little feet.
And so cute.
That is the problem. It's so cute. It's so cute, but behind that cuteness, you have the horror. The horror not only of what they do to the animals, but the horror of nutrition, because there you don't have even the chicken. You have like other parts that they're not nutrition. Mm-hmm. So we do that a lot with language. I mean, language is never innocent. It's always political, you know? And with language, you can cover the world or you can uncover it, and poetry especially, I think that uncovers the world. Mm-mm. That is why literature and books and poetry are beaten and books are burned during dictatorships. Because if you read, you can start thinking and looking at the world in a different way.
And literally silencing the mind as well.
Yeah.
Paula? Can I ask you a question?
Of course.
Because you stopped eating meat in Argentina. That's very hard because everybody eats meat like pretty much every day. How was that?
Well, it was really a difficult experience at first because I couldn't believe. I mean, you are reacting because I stopped eating meat. What is the problem? If you stop eating fruit, I said this yesterday in another event, but really, if you stop eating fruit, nobody will tell you anything. Nobody will react. But if you stop eating meat in Argentina, they do things like you take your food, your vegetarian food, to a barbecue, and people that eat meat will eat your food. Or if you say, I'm a vegetarian, and you go to an event, and they will serve you ham. Ham?
Oh, yeah, because that's not real meat. Yeah, jambal.
Because it's not meat, but it is. I mean, it comes from a pig that they killed, you know? So I couldn't believe it. So what happened to me is that I desnaturalized the eating of meat, and I start looking not at a beef, but a part of a corpse. Mm-mm. So there I thought, okay, this is a part of an animal, and we are animals, so we can be there hanging on the butcher shop.
Yep.
And that was the idea for the novel. And then I researched for 6 months before I typed the first word, but that is the, was the idea.
Thank you.
And also you become really ostracized when you don't eat meat, because I do that too. And it's like you get socially punished for not eating the meat, for not like being part of the social, of the ritual, in which there's always, you know, this man who is cutting the meat, and you are kind of like having a piece of him. So it's also a little bit like, if you could, I mean, you can put a Lacanian gaze and see that it is a homosexual in the Freudian sense,
ritual,
where you know, where the man is just like sharing, you know, his parts for everyone to see. And in fact, like, they always cut, like, so is it tender enough for you? And like, even with the with the knife, and you have to eat it from the knife, like, yeah, oh, it's really tender. Like that's part of the, that's the ritual.
It's very Christian as well, in a sense, very like Christian. Serving the body of Christ, Paula, I want to ask you the last question, and then I'm going to leave everyone to the darkness of the night. Well, Agustina obviously did a lot of research in the bio industry. Your research is maybe self-lived, traveling across the world as a writer to know the horrors of the literary world. But I would like to ask you, what makes language come alive? Because there's, in the novel, there's a discussion by the writers at the festival, and they discuss language. And one accuses Mona, the main character, of having dead characters in a novel. And then she asks, would it be a zombie novel? And she's actually quite excited about that idea. And you use that paradigm of horror to criticize maybe the lifelessness of intellectuality, or maybe the dryness of language.
Well, what I love most in life are novels of ideas. This is like, to me, this is my kind of horror genre, the novel of ideas. This is what I love. So in my first book, like which is called The Savage Theories, it was the intellectual life and as a zombie land that I wanted to pay attention to and that I wanted to play with. How, you know, there is this romanticization of the Montonero, like, you know, the heroes of the 1970s, which were in fact the victims of the dictatorship, because in a country where there is no aristocracy or no actual heroes, the only heroes are the victims. And this has always been my quest, like to research into these things that haunt me, that kind of like are, you know, after me, like you know, like seedlings, like I don't know, like beings that are alive, and when I find like something that is haunting me and pressing on me, such as sometimes I don't know contemporary culture, in the way that it has become so, I don't know, like this, you know, like the papist of ethics, and like how everybody has to be like a very, very nice person, and how evil is, like, I don't know, is this totem that everybody's dancing around. And so, well, this is kind of like part of the research that I do, but I utilize myself as a character. I don't really like do the, or in Mona, it wasn't really my story. It was the story of somebody that went through a terrifying situation. But of course, like, I could use like every time I had felt terror in order to create it. So I think that's how you empathize with horror, and horror becomes something very plastic and very magical if you want to make books, or if you want to make poems or things like that. I don't know. I think horror is a power that lives within you.
I think that's the most powerful last words of an interview I've ever heard. Horror is a power that lives within you, within me, within everyone. Thank you so much. Can I have a hand of applause for my dear friends and, well, interviewees, Paula, and Agustina, and of course, Jente van Stockum. Thank you. And as promised, I give you back to the night. Thank you.